won't fight, I won't strive, but I'll lean all my life on you. You take the pressure off my shoulders, you make my soul a little lighter. In the world, in a rush, I will rest and I'll trust in you. You are the cares on you. You're the prince of my peace, I can finally breathe with you. You take the world right off my shoulders, when I'm anxious you're the solace. In the face of my fears, I will cast all my cares on you. You are the
gosh, speaking of rest, you all look very well rested this morning, eh? Yeah? Isn't there something about when you crawl into bed and you know, like you just get an extra hour? It's a good thing.
The 5 and 3-year-old at our house did not understand that.
Yeah.
They came running down, hello, and it's like it's 4:15.
Great welcome to worship this morning. If you're joining us online this morning, good morning and welcome here in this place. A few quick announcements.
Yep.
Important things for you to, we're thinking ahead a little bit, so there's some stuff in the calendar we want to make sure that you're aware of. Yeah.
Yeah, you'll notice a few things on the back of the sermon notes for sure, and midweek is back this week. We'll be back together on Friday nights. It's pasta night, so if anybody feels like they've got something special pasta-wise they want to share with us, the list is on the board, so please sign up. But we hope all of you come and hang out with us because Thursday nights are so much fun.
Yeah, they are. Super. Also, November 17th is our anniversary Sunday service.
It is.
And so a couple things to keep in note on that. First and foremost, if you're interested, we want to feed you breakfast. And so you're welcome to come at 9:30 in Harrington Hall and join us for breakfast preceding the service. Reverend Peter Cusick, he's done some work with our board in the past. He's an important mentor for me. He's going to be our guest speaker. Yeah, super good guy. How many of you know George? I tell him this all the time. You know who George Carlin is? You know the. Okay, so imagine George Carlin as a pastor for 42 years, okay?
That is Peter.
This is Reverend Peter Cusick. So he has a fantastic message. We've been talking about that already. The other thing, we have some baptisms that are going to take place that day as well. So you don't want to miss Anniversary Sunday.
It's going to be a celebration.
Yeah, it's going to be a real celebration, sure. Yep.
I'd like to invite Heather to come up and share. There's a really amazing prayer event happening tomorrow night that she's going to share with us about.
So, women, this is for you. Tomorrow evening, November 4th, is the annual Women's World Day of Prayer.
Thank you. Women's World Day of Prayer, tomorrow evening, 7 a.m. It's an opportunity for you to, first of all, I mean, we come as individuals, we come to our church family, and we connect here, and then we have a tier up where Canadian Baptist Women of Ontario and Quebec, 300 churches across Ontario and Quebec, are women gathered together. And then there's Canadian Baptist Women above that, and that's our four regions, all of our women from those regions are under that. And then there's Baptist Women's North America, which is 15 organizations in Canada and the United States. And then there's Baptist World Alliance, and it's Baptist World Alliance that puts together the Global Day of Prayer. It's been happening for about 75 years. Mm-hmm. I would invite any woman who is interested to attend. Mm-hmm. It's online, it's at 7 p.m. And if you go to CBWOQ, Canadian Baptist Women of Ontario and Quebec, cbwoq.ca, you'll find the link that you need to get there. There are prayer guides and prayer resources. There's a Bible study as well. Use any of those resources or join tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. The connections that we make at all of those different levels are significant and they're life-giving, but the connection that we can make to God as we join together in prayer with Him as women from around the world is really significant to the difference that we can make in the world. The theme is purposeful living, and I hope you'll join us tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thanks, Heather. Don't worry about that.
Just another quick announcement. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Quick announcement, but very important one. We have our fall business meeting of the members coming up the end of this month, so Sunday, November 24th. And there will be more information coming forth on that in the future weeks. But a very important part of that meeting is to vote on our slate of officers, elected officers for this church for the year 2025. Your nominating committee has been quite busy. We only have two vacancies yet to fill. But the post is up in the narthex. There's two bulletin boards that have the list of the names in the elected positions. I want you to be aware of those because those names, the new names to those lists, will be voted on at the business meeting. Now, there are some rules. You can't just turn to your left and nominate somebody, so I have to read these rules. If you wish to propose another active member to be considered for service in one of those positions to be voted on, you must submit a written nomination signed by five or more other active members, along with the nominated member's signature. So you can't just turn to the left and suggest someone's name. Then it has to be considered by the nominating committee. So these considerations, applications need to be filled in and given to me before next Saturday, November 9th. I'm going to be away most of the week, so good luck. You can leave it in the office. Thank you.
Great.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, those are important dates, so I hope you'll be able to participate with them. But, you know, you didn't come here this morning necessarily to hear about dates, and you didn't come here this morning to get something in your calendar. You came here to worship Him, and so you're welcome here. This is not a place of strangers. Everybody is welcome in God's house. Each of you are welcome here as we gather to worship. And one of the things I just want to seed into your mind as we open up our time of worship this morning are these words. In our lives, there are no divisions, right? God dwells in each one of us. And so when you come here this morning, when you participate with one another in worship this morning, you're part of his family, but you're part of him and him and you too. And so receive that this morning. That should be reason enough for us to worship. And so welcome, friends.
Good morning, FBK. Welcome to worship. Yeah. Please stand and join with us in singing if you're able.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the your holy name.
worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never.
Seated, Laura.
Good morning, FBK. It didn't work last week. And then Robbie made it idiot proof, so now I can't mess it up, he says, but, you know, give me a moment. Okay, little worshipers, do you want to see what's in here today? What have I got? It's nice and bright, isn't it? Jesus said we were supposed to be like a light on a hill, right? But sometimes things happen in life, and it covers us. We kind of wear it, don't we? Is it still bright? See it, right? But then more things happen, right? Kind of see it. We don't give those things to God, and they pile up, and they pile up until our light isn't there anymore. This morning, we're going to look at the life of someone who, no matter what was happening, his light was shining brightly. So, little worshipers, if you're curious who this might be, you would join me in Harrington Hall. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be here, to be learning with one another, to be leaning into your spirit and to be guided. What an exciting adventure this is. So, Heavenly Father, as we go out and the little ones hear something new and extraordinary, I pray that they will become fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ, inviting others to do the very same thing. Be with us, Father. We ask all of this in your Son's precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Before Pastor Marlee comes to bring us the word this morning, I just want to pray with you, and then we'll have our hearts prepared for what we hear. Lord, you sent for us a helper. You sent an advocate, your Holy Spirit, to be with us after you went back to your throne. And so it's on that Spirit that we call upon this morning. See, it's the Spirit that you sent for us that convicts us. Each time, you know, whether it's in this past week or past times in our lives, each time that we have strayed from your word, we have strayed from the path that you have made so clear to us, your Spirit steps in. Not just to convict us, but I think to encourage us to come before you and acknowledge that which you know, so that we might have a discussion about that with you. So, helper God, would you be the hope that overcomes our despair? Would you be the love that overcomes our hatred? Would you be the mercy that overcomes the sin that we confess to you this morning where that's appropriate, and just set us free from these prisons that are so often of our own making. Forgive us, Lord. Watch over us, Lord. And welcome us home, Lord. Home into your care. I pray that to you this morning. Amen. You know, when you do that, it's not just the opportunity to ready your heart for a message or to hear from God's word. I hope for you, it's freeing. And it's this wonderful indication of how much God loves you that he creates this opportunity for us to come to him, confess, and then let go, right? Because that's an important part of this. You let go of those burdens. Receive that this morning. I'm going to ask Marlee to come this morning. We've been talking very specifically with you. This is week four, right? So we've been talking very specifically about how practically we can practice the way. One of the things we've invited you to consider is an intentional time with God. But there's another component that you're going to talk to us about that is not just intentional time of God, but something for us that I think we're deeply in need of in this time, aren't we? Yep. Yeah. Okay, bless you.
Thanks.
Like Dave said, this is our fourth week in our message series about following Jesus based on John Mark Comer's book, Practicing the Way. And the practices of Jesus are essential to our spiritual formation. And practicing them is how we actually find the way of Jesus. They are how we do what we can do, how we can, you know, have Sabbath, prayer, read scriptures. It's in these spaces that we make space for God to transform us into the kind of people who can do what we currently can't do, this live and love like Jesus. And then they also help to slow our busy lives down to this pace so that we can actually see the presence of the God of peace and all of that as well. The other part we keep talking about too is the reframing of us, that we're not just becoming disciples as we think about it, but that we're actually becoming apprentices of Jesus, right? Because the point of apprenticeship with Jesus or with any rabbi in his time was that we were intentionally being with a person so much, so closely, that you're actually becoming who they are. Like we keep talking about too, is this following your rabbi so closely in the day that you would actually be covered in their dust, right? The other thing I want to say, and I know we've, you know, this is the moments of repetition week after week, but it's so important because the question isn't, are you being formed? The question is, who and what are you being formed into? That's a weighty question for all of us, but it's so important. And the good part is, you are here. You are listening, you are reading, you're contemplating how to do all these things. In turn, you are working hard to grow and improve in your following of Jesus. The truth is, though, Jesus is offering us a different way, a new way. In the book, in this section, Comer talks about it's not willpower. It's not about how many Bible studies can you get in a week. And I love how Comer says, and it's not a zap from heaven that's going to make it all fall into place. It's about us intentionally and purposefully creating time and space for God to work inside of us. One of the things, it was really interesting this week, how what we were going to talk about today, what we were reading in the book, and then our Tuesday night ladies' Bible study as we're journeying through Luke, it all kind of meshed together this week, which was really, really cool when God does those things. But then you're like, okay, apparently this is something I really, really need to know. So in our ladies' Bible study this week, one of the lines from Luke that she wanted us to take away was Jesus saying, I'm here with an invitation to changed life, changed from the inside out. Because really, that's what Jesus is offering us. It's not about us doing all of this on our own. It's about Him changing us from the inside out if we're willing to go there. In 2 Corinthians, in chapter 3, it says, and we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into His image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. These practices that we keep talking about, they are meant to help us achieve this transformation. Comer also says, the practices are disciplines based on the lifestyle of Jesus that create this time and space for us to access the presence and power of the Spirit, and in doing so, be transformed from the inside out. Bit of a theme there, right? We can't transform ourselves by mere effort. But we can participate in God's transforming work by practicing these ancient discipline, spiritual disciplines. They're also the practices that are modeled by Jesus for us to follow. The other thing I think we have to remember, too, is they're not meant to be burdens. They're not meant to be something else. They're going to be number five on our to-do list for this week. The goal is that these become rhythms of grace given to us to help open us up to His presence and His power. They're a means, but not the end. Their scripture shows us over and over again that we are part of this. In 1 Timothy, it says, train yourself to be godly. Philippians 2 says, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill His good purpose. Spiritual practices are not meant to be our latest addition to our to-do list. Like I said, I know we all have enough of that. But they have been given to us to help us cultivate this deeper, stronger relationship with God and transform our hearts so that we are able to become more like Jesus, more like our rabbi. The goal is not performance, but actual participation in Jesus' work of renewal. For a couple of years now, I have been involved with a spiritual director. I'll be honest, it wasn't something that I really thought I needed, I thought I wanted, I thought this is going to be one more thing on my monthly to-do list. Somewhere along the way, not too far in to my times with her, I realized that these were really, really special times, that they were amazing moments that I got to participate in each month, where it gave me this space to sit down and reflect back on my month and notice where the Spirit had been showing up. Maybe in those spaces I did notice it, maybe it was something I hadn't noticed, but it was really great. And the best part has been over these last 2 years, how much more noticing I am able to do in the moments. I keep a journal of my times with her each month. And at the beginning of our sessions, there was a lot of wows, and literally, W-O-W, !! In big, huge letters in my journal. Was so cool, even in the not noticing, then the wow of really noticing. He was there all along. Now it's more notes of where I've seen him. Not quite so many wows, but they're still pretty wow. God's power works through our intentional practices. We can't transform ourselves all by ourselves, but we have to do our part. When we make spaces in our regular rhythms for things like prayer and fasting and Sabbath and silence, it gives the Spirit this space to actually show up and then show us that He's been there all along. Like I said, do I get it perfect? Absolutely not. There's still lots of wows with lots of exclamation points in my journals, but we have to remember, the goal isn't actually perfection because we can't do that. There's only one that was perfect, and that wasn't any of us. But it is about this partnership with the Spirit, with God, that we're in on this journey of transformation together, and the noticing is so extra special then. And this is where our growth, real honest to goodness growth with our God, actually begins. in the book in this section about becoming like Jesus, Comer uses this analogy of this decision to go out and run a marathon. You don't just go and pick out a pair of really cool new running shoes, though you would do that, of course. You didn't have any reason to buy shoes. But you don't get them, put them on, and go, okay, I'm going to run 26 miles today, right? That's not how that works. You buy the shoes, right? And then you make this plan of training. And you start training, right? 1 mile at a time, 1 day at a time, 1 week at a time. And if it's 26 miles, we're going to talk about 1 month at a time because it's going to take a bit. And by the time you get to the end of your training plan, you are able to run 26.2 miles and complete a marathon. In 1 Corinthians 9, Paul says, "Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize." See, even Paul compares our spiritual growth to a race. Training and discipline are essential, but the ultimate prize is given by God. It's also why we keep talking about over and over about this word abide and the passage in John that talks about the vine and the branches. Because can you imagine going out and trying to force a tree to grow fruit by yelling at it, pulling at it? Or maybe you just ignore it completely. It doesn't work, does it? Is that how it's going to grow fruit? The tree grows and produces fruit because the farmer takes care of it, right? He makes sure it has enough fertilizer, makes sure it has enough water and sunlight. He keeps the weeds away from it. In the same way, we can't make ourselves more loving or joyful, peaceful, kind, good, faithful, gentle, or to have more self-control overnight, right? By practicing these rhythms that we keep talking about, prayer and scripture, Sabbath, and intentional time with Jesus, by actually abiding with him, then and only then can we open ourselves to God's life-giving presence and the changes and transformation that will happen. Because that's when he begins this change, this slow and steady change from the inside out, just like he planned for us all along. So one of the hardest things, I think, in that list I've given you so far to get our heads wrapped around is this idea of the S word, Sabbath, right? It's tough. It's hard. This week, honestly, it's been a huge conversation between us as the pastors. Multiple times we've just sat and went, how do we do this well? How do we do this better? But it also came up, we had a whole section on it in our Tuesday night Bible study. One of the questions in our Bible study she had asked us, and I put it in your sermon notes. When you think of the word Sabbath, what's the first word or feeling that came to mind? Sabbath. I think for most people, the word rest comes to mind. For me, it was an exhale. Our English word Sabbath actually comes from the Hebrew word Shabbat, which means to cease. The heart of Shabbat is the command to cease our work so that we might remember God's work. that was a great explanation. Because what really matters is what the heart of it is, right? So what is God's work? The explanation that we had given to us is that his work is an amazing restoration of all of us who believe. In Revelation 21:5, it says, "He who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.'" You guys know I like to look at all different translations when we're working through passages in the Bible, and I loved here what the Message said, but it's actually three verses, so it's verses 3-5. It says, "I heard a voice thunder from the throne. 'Look, look, God has moved into the neighborhood, making his home with men and women. They're his people. He's their God. He'll wipe every tear from their eyes. Death is gone for good. Tears gone. Crying gone. Pain gone. All the first order of things gone.' Then the enthroned continued, 'Look, I'm making everything new. Write it all down. Each word is dependable and accurate.'" Don't you love that idea of God moving into your neighborhood, making his home right here with us, intentionally, purposefully? Isn't that what Jesus did? Isn't that why he came? He came down and made his home here to show us what life with him looks like, what it's really supposed to look like. And then he provided an opportunity. He didn't stop at being with us. He didn't stop at showing us. He stopped when he gave us this opportunity for us to be restored to him and saved. What a good God we have. He is always intentional. He is always purposeful. He is dependable. He is accurate. I think our biggest problem with this idea of Sabbath, maybe I should say problems, is us, right? I think the first problem is we're just not very good at it. We see it, we know it, we hear it. This is not the first time we've preached on it, but we're just not very good at it. The other part is, I think we don't really understand what it actually means. So then it stops us. It keeps us away in our misunderstanding it. Then we don't even think it's really that important. Do we even really want it? Are we longing for it? So if you're not wanting it, how are we ever going to get good at it? Homer says, "One of the most important practices for our age of exhaustion is Sabbath, a full day set aside to stop, rest, delight, and worship." We know this. We live in a world that never stops. Everything is 24/7, right at our fingertips. But if it's right at our fingertips 24/7, then that means there's got to be people out there doing their jobs or being accessible 24/7, which then leaves us all exhausted and worn out, because if they're going, then we have to be going, then they're going, and we're going, and it's this snowball effect of never stopping. Then we look at this idea of Sabbath and rest, and then it overwhelms us. We immediately think that if I practice Sabbath, that means I'm going to be doing nothing, which then scares the heck out of us. Because how can we do nothing? We can't not do something. Doing nothing means nothing. I think Comer actually did a really great job. I know for me, in reframing what Sabbath truly is, so that maybe we can actually get it for the first time ever. Practicing Sabbath is a day to stop, a day to rest, a day to delight, and a day to worship. This allows us a space to actually reconnect with God, reminding us that our identity is not found in what we produce or what we do, but our identity is found in God's love for us and the work he did for us. Jesus showed us this over and over and over again in the Bible, how important this time of Shabbat was. He was a Jewish rabbi. He practiced Shabbat weekly, right? From sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday, a full 24-hour period. And never once did he say, oh yeah, and that Shabbat thing, you can just ignore that. He never said that. In Mark, it says, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. The Sabbath is not just a rule to follow, but it has been given to us as a gift to restore our souls. It's a time for us to remember that God is in control, and he loves us, and he cares for us. Through resting, delighting in good things, and worshiping, we can realign our hearts with God. And that gives us this opportunity to live differently from the hurried and restless world that surrounds us. So this week, we begin with one practice. It's a biggie, but one, Sabbath. We've been going through the scriptures of Matthew 28 to 30. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. As I was going through this, of course, I had to see what the message had to say about this. And I think Eugene Peterson did an amazing job in putting this passage into words that actually we might finally get and understand and take in. So I encourage you, close your eyes and just listen to the words that are being spoken to you. Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't let anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Did you hear that? Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. For our challenge this week, it's all in your sermon notes. Start small. Start small by practicing Sabbath. Doesn't have to be a full day. It can be half a day. It can be a few hours. But take some time to stop and truly rest. Find this space in your week. Put it in your calendar. Write it in pen so it becomes non-negotiable. Well, you'll see, we put a description in your sermon notes, the four elements. Stop. Cease from work and striving. Let go of your to-do lists in this space and trust that God will hold everything in his hands. You don't need to hold it in this space. Number two, rest. Reconnect with God through stillness and refresh your body and soul. Rest can be different for everybody. For somebody here on the platform, it would definitely be a nap. For the other one, it would be curling up in my comfy chair with a book that I'm longing to read. Maybe for you, it's watching a movie that's been on your list that you never get to. Rest doesn't mean that you have to sleep. It means slowing down. Number three, delight. And I love this word. Spend time doing things that bring you great joy. It might be enjoying a meal, It might be taking a walk, being out in your yard, spending time with your friends or your loved ones, playing games, chatting, whatever. Whatever it is for you that brings great delight, that's what you do in this space. Number four, last but certainly not least, is worship. Take time to reflect on God's goodness and spend time in gratitude with Him. Again, make this your space. How do you like to worship? Maybe it's reading scripture. Maybe it's listening to some great Christian music playlist. Maybe it's stillness or quiet. Maybe it's a combination of all of the above. The point is, find what works for you in this space to show your worshipfulness, show your gratitude. Where do you find and see God's goodness? This simple rhythm of stopping, resting, delighting, and worshiping will help you experience God's presence in a deeper way. These practices are all about opening us up to God's transforming work in our lives as we journey with Jesus as His apprentice. Remember, the purpose of these practices is not to add more to your list or to your week. It's not to burden you. The goal is they help us to learn and live and love like Jesus. It's to help us live a life of more as His apprentices, right? To be with Him as He's showing us, intentionally showing us what kingdom living really looks like. He's inviting us to slow down, create spaces to be with Him, and be changed into so much more than we can ever imagine. At the end of this section in Comer's book, Becoming Like Jesus, the last paragraph of it just really stuck with me, so I want to share that. Something approaching Christ-likeness is possible in this life. It really, really is. We can be healed. We can be set free of broken patterns that stretch back generations. We can be transformed into people who are genuinely pervaded by love, joy, and peace. Our souls can throb with the bliss of union with God. Our bodies can become temples, our neighborhoods holy ground, our days eternity in time, our moments miracles. All in good time. For now, the Master's call is simple. Follow me. As we practice these disciplines, especially Sabbath, we begin to align our lives with God's rhythm. And then that allows Him the space to renew our hearts and our minds. Another one of the practices Jesus shared with us is communion. Mm. It's coming to His table. Communion isn't an obligation, it's a celebration. Communion celebrates the gospel. Jesus has broken this for us so that we can be fixed with Him.
You know, I think so often that celebrating communion really marks the story of Jesus' life. You know, why God sent Him. Sent Him here to do what we weren't going to be able to do for ourselves. The Lord knew that. And so He sent Jesus to give Himself completely for us so that we might be saved completely, that we might have eternal rest completely. That's the story of what we do and what we celebrate at this table, what we remember. They were celebrating the Passover meal. They were already remembering the work that God had done for them as the nation of Israel. We share a place with them. Because now here at this table, we're remembering what the Lord did for us. In that upper room, he took bread. He gave thanks for it. He broke it. And he said, "This is my body, given for you. Take it, eat it, and remember," he said.
And he took the cup of wine, thanked God for it, and said to his friends, "This is my blood given to you as a new agreement between humans and God. Every time you drink it, remember me."
Just as the grain that was used to make this bread and the grapes that would have been used to make the wine that he put together, those are the components of the meal, but they're symbols for us of the components of the work that he did and the promise that we receive when we remember. Take those elements now and truly remember.
Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, Lord God, you rule over us with strength and power and such amazing light. Mm-hmm. Father, let your Spirit be with us to confirm what has already taken place in our hearts. That you are here with us, that you love us. May we truly have the joy and trust that even under all the strain and stress of our lives, you fill us with a light that can shine into the darkness of the whole world for all your people. Father, help us, encourage us, that we too can go out and shine that light, because that is part of why you created us, to go and share you with all the world. And in that, we just get to be closer and closer and closer to you. Father, within the stillness of our days, we offer the stillness of our beings, our minds, our hands, our souls, and in that quiet space, let us feel your love and hear you whisper to us one more time, "You are my beloved." Father, strengthen our faith for the future, our faith in everything good. Give us the opportunity to be your light here. And in that, may we and all the world truly bring praise and honor to you. I ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. I'd invite you to stand as we close this morning with our final hymn.
Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. Each winding path I tread gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Though my weary steps may falter and my soul athirst may be, gushing from the rock before me, low a spring joy I see, gushing from the rock before me, lo, a spring of joy I see. Savior leads me, all the fullness of his love, perfect rest to me is promised in my Father's house above. When my spirit cloth immortal wings its flight to realms of day, this my song through endless ages, Jesus, lend me all the way. This my song through endless ages, Jesus, lend me all the way.
You know, Sabbath won't just happen. You have to be intentional about this. I promise you it's absolutely worth it to know that there's rest, to know that there's this love there that he wants you to experience as a regular part of your week. So here's my encouragement for you. Take time today to start planning for your Sabbath this week. For some of you, this is going to be foreign. It's okay. But it takes intentional preparation. But I'll tell you, the outcome is so worth the effort.
So go now and follow the way of Jesus. Rest in him. And in that rest, simply just be with him.
Yes.
We are praying and encouraging you all this week. Have a great week.
Yeah, bless you.